Welcome back to our laboratory of the endless exploration of Chernobyl technologies. Our today hero is a part of the SKALA, a nuclear reactor control computer of the Chernobyl nuclear power plant. That system accumulated and processed thousands of signals from equipment and analyzed the physical processes inside the reactor. This way, it provided critical assistance to the reactor operators using a set of teletypes and mnemonic displays. Well, given that 400,000 people watched this documentary so far, we believe it is worth to continue, and many of you asked us to make more videos about the hardware and software of this unique computer complex, which we happily do for you. It will take quite many episodes and a lot of interesting lab work, which you will find here. And in regards of this, a tiny spoiler, so in this briefcase is one of our future exhibits, so I suggest you to take a guess at what's inside. But we will start right today with this device, used in the SKALA computer to make some very important input operations. We were lucky to get exactly the same as the one at the power plant. This is FS1501 punch tape reader, made in Czechoslovakia in 1970s by Factory of Industrial Automation in Prague. In the booklet, the factory claimed that this reader was the fastest in the world at that moment. Well, it could be so, because it is photoelectric, so it could read around 1500 symbols per second, which is roughly 4 meters of punch tape. So we will try it in action today, perhaps for the very first time in a few decades. But first, it needs some quite an extreme restoration. Before we do all that, let me remind you on a few essential technical details. So, SKALA in itself is not a binary, but an octal computer that used 24-bit words, and its programs were written in a machine code and stored on a standard magnetic tapes, like this one. To read and write those tapes, it used 6 high-speed tape reel drives of type ES5070, manufactured by Czechoslovakia factory in East Germany. Originally, they were designed for the ESAVM system, a Soviet architectural clone of IBM 360 mainframes. But here, they were adapted to SKALA hardware using some custom interfaces. In native ES systems, preparing data on a magnetic tape would in many cases involve using the ES9002. It was a special device for program preparation, but in SKALA, the approach was different. Instead, for this was used a control panel of the chief computer engineer, or DIVT. So, when it came to making corrections to programs, altering parts of working algorithms, or actual booting up the system, all of it happened here. But on a punch tape, that encodes the data using a set of holes. So SKALA tape used 6 holes for data, and 1 small for synchronization track. So there were 2 specialized devices attached to this control panel. One was FS1501 high-speed tape reader, and another one was PL150M tape punch machine, which we, by the way, reviewed a few months ago. If you haven't seen that episode, be sure to check it out as well. By the way, based on that animation, we made absolutely amazing posters about SKALA, and we still have some available. So if you would like to have some, check the linked post in the description below. Well, a funny fact is that the person who sold it to us actually had no idea what the device actually is, and moreover, it had been stored in a chicken shed for about 20 years. So obviously there is a massive damage, rust and dirt. Okay, let's open it. Well, the top cover is quite rusty, but well, it's manageable. Oh my god. Well, some parts are very dusty, but this is nothing compared to the amount of trash we have inside. Oh my god. Okay, so first I will use some Canadair to blow out all the seats. You know, to help you understand the scale of this disaster, this is just a half of what I removed from inside, and I needed to completely wash the table, I think, at least 4 times. Okay, I want to remove the covers of the reading clamp to check the mechanism. Decorative elements such as a model tag unfortunately are missing here, but it is not that critical. And all the screws also are rusty, so I will change all that later when I assemble it all back. Okay, so visually it's surprisingly quite okay, but it also needs to be cleaned and lubricated. Well, these covers I will wash and then retrobrite a little, because they have still some yellowing. Well, I'm not sure if it will work well during this season, not enough light, but at least I'll try. As for the device itself, the overall complication is that here is a complex wiring inside, so really there's no chance to disassemble it completely. So instead I will very carefully wash everything as is, piece by piece. Better. Actually, much better. In fact, there I think was 5 rounds of washing. Some parts are covered with compacted dust, and it's quite important to get rid of it because there are components which get pretty hot during their operation. Okay, now I will take out all the socket boards, and of course we will take a closer look at them a bit later. And cleaning the rear panel. As you can see, one of the interface connectors is a bit damaged, and unfortunately there is no chance to change it right at the moment, because those connectors unfortunately are proprietary and it's really really hard to find them. But at least I will change those rusty screws to some newer. This little panel appeared not to be that much deformed as it looks. In fact, it feels that someone just tried to smash open it and look inside. And it's also not yellowed on the back, so I'll cheat a little and install it just reversely. Finally, there were some small scratches on these blue parts, so I fixed them with the modeling paint. And as for that rusty cover, well, initially I thought to clean it and then use some spray paint on it. But then I got a little bit better idea and eventually brought it to car paint workshop. So the guys there found a matching raw cover and applied coating in industrial way. So now it looks absolutely like a brand new one. Wow, really, really good. And I have to say that money spent are almost the same. So this is what we got now. Much better. Chickens. And now let's take a closer look at the internals and also do some necessary servicing. Fortunately, we have an original documentation, which, by the way, you can find scanned on our Patreon page. I have to say, it was a really big luck to find it specifically in a paper form. For the last time I have seen it as a paper at the Chernobyl 2 Duga Reader Data Center, where FS readers were also used in their mainframes. And a quick side note, notice how this document differs from a typical Soviet counterpart in terms of design and quality. I mean, it is well illustrated, written in human language and presented in some sort of understandable way. And this tiny difference is something I noticed in many pieces of documentation made specifically across the socialist bloc. The centerpiece of our device is this large 25-watt asynchronous motor that handles the tape transport, and above it there is this huge startup capacitors attached to the motor. Like practically all components inside, it was made by Tesla, another Czechoslovak producer of electronics. So when you switch the reader on, the motor will start rotating right immediately. In fact, one edge of its rotor has a fan that cools down the stack of socket boards. But at the same time, this also means that the roller, which moves the tape, will rotate continuously as well. So to control start and stop operations, they developed a special mechanism. So as you can see, beneath the main roller there is an electromagnet, and above it there is a small roller which is mounted on such a flat spring. So when the clamp is locked and the magnet is released, there is a small distance between those two rollers. But if you activate the magnet, they stick together and catch the tape. It's logical that ensuring precise tape start and stop moments is pretty crucial for correct reading of data, so we have an electromagnetic brake here as well. So this another small magnet, which is connected to these two pods, interacts with the corresponding part above that stops the tape when the magnet is active. And you can adjust the power of the magnets using these two huge resistors. Well, on a side note, I just noticed that one of them had a damaged ring, so I got a replacement and I will repair it. The reader itself was designed to be universal, to be used not only for computers but also for CNC machines. So it could handle two types of punch tapes, 22.5 and 17.5 mm. Hence, there is this selector which triggers a microswitch that deactivates a few of the sensors if a narrower tape is used. Another microswitch signals when the clamp is closed. And the actual sensor is in the middle. It is based on 9 photoresistors, 8 are for data and 1 for synchronization track. They are connected to processing sockets with this ribbon cable with a connector, so if something, it can be easily replaced. And the light comes with the sensor from this powerful light bulb to a lens and a prism, and the brightness of the light you can adjust using this resistor. The cover has a little opening that allows to visually control the reading process. Well, as I told, here should be a decorative part, so ideally it should look this way. And signals from the sensor go to this crate with socket boards. Well, I already cleaned them less or more, so let's reinstall them back. The uppermost board, equipped with these three powerful transistors, is the main power stabilizer. Below is somewhat similar board, which is a tape transport controller. Next, we have three signal formers, each connected to three photoresistors from the sensor assembly. These formers are linked to the last two boards, which provide the interface connection. And here is interesting part. So there were various types of these two boards, featuring different input and output signals. So according to the user manual, these readers could be found in practically any ESVM mainframe, but also they were compatible with many types of foreign computers, such as those made in the UK, Germany, Sweden, Poland, France, and even in the United States. It is even specifically mentioned that it is compatible with American UNIVAC 1004. You had to install these three boards of the correct type according to this table. Well, we have the most widespread combination, B/P, which is easily to connect to RS-232 using a microcontroller in between. And communication with the computer is established using these two 20-pin connectors on the back panel. So K2 is a control connector and K1 is the data connector. Here is a tiny request, especially if you are from former Czechoslovakia. We very much need a couple of this very type of connectors. Unfortunately, they are proprietary for this very factory, and the exact part number is unfortunately unknown, so we could not find them here in Ukraine. If you have some, we will gladly purchase from you. So I fixed that damaged resistor, placed a faulty wire of the lamp back, and also installed some fresh fuses. Well, I hope this huge power supply will work flawlessly, so we can proceed. We need to make a test connector in which a few pins will be wired together, and then by connecting pin 1 to pin 6 we can start the tape, and connecting it to pin 7 will stop the tape. So I made such a makeshift solution, which I believe will be totally sufficient. And start! Okay, so the lamp is glowing and the motor is rotating. Excellent. Well, I actually believed that it would be way louder than this, but it's amazing. Great. So now for a moment, let's switch it off and place the tape inside. The tape is not moving, which is as should be. And action! Wow, that's fast. Okay, let's try to take a longer tape. Okay, so works perfectly. I think for the next time we'll need to bring the tape roller back, because now it is in storage. Because without it, this is really a mess. However, we have been told that in the cases the roller was not available, they used just a box to catch the tape. Okay, and finally let's assemble back all the casing and take a look to the restored machine. Well, just look at this. I think it's a really great difference. Well, we could not make a proper retro brighting, but it's much better comparing to our initial chicken shed victim. Okay, so looks like a good beginning. And what's next? Actually, making this reader fully functional would be absolutely amazing, because we have a lot of wireless tapes we would like to read, and this way find if there is something really interesting on them. So far we could find few variants of possible schematics of the adapter, all based on microcontrollers. So we will think about which one to use and actually make it work completely. But also about that, as well as some bonus materials and scanned documentation for this reader, you can find on our Patreon page. So don't forget to check it out. And in meanwhile, get ready for the next episode where we will figure out what is inside that interesting briefcase. And that's it for today, and see you next time.